Welcome to Traces of the Lost World. We are here speaking to Bill DiMichele. Can you tell us a little bit about where we are and what we are going to find out here?
Well, we're currently in the Robledo Mountains in what's today New Mexico, but long ago, back in the early Permian period, which is all around 300 million, a little less than that, 290 something, this was in the western part of a giant supercontinent called today, which we call Pangaea, where all the major continents, Europe, Asia, South and North America, were welded together into one big landmass. We were on the western edge of that continent, fairly close to the ocean. And growing near there were forests of primitive conifers. They would be very distant relatives of some of these plants that we see here now, some of the cone-producing plants. And along that coastline, there were various kinds of environments in which these conifers lived, died, and their remains were deposited. So what we see behind us, these red rocks, were flood horizons in which these conifers were carried in and deposited in these shoreline settings. So we're in the tropical region at this time, probably very close to the equator. It's probably warm, it's probably seasonal, and if we were to go further to the east at this same time, let's say into the central part of the United States, the Appalachian Mountains, you would find different kinds of plants living there. These plants would be reflecting this strongly seasonally dry environment here on the western edge of the continent. So overall, you're in a very unusual kind of setting here compared to where we typically find fossils of this age. Most of the exploration for fossils goes on in places where the exposures often have economic interests, like coal mining or so on. And some of that happens out east, and we have a very different perspective of what lives in that part of the world than what lives out here. So this is an unusual and important place because of the types of fossils that we find here.
So now you mentioned that this used to be a sea. It looks so different. Right now we're in the middle of the desert.
Right.
It's hard to picture how different this environment could have been. Could you describe maybe how it was? Mm-hmm.
You're probably very close to a coastline. So the rocks we're actually standing on that are under our feet are limestones that were deposited in the ocean. And then the rocks behind us, the red rocks, were rocks that were deposited on land in the near coastal or near shoreline setting. And so you have the interfingering of the marine environment and the terrestrial environment along this shoreline. And the sea would rise and it would flood the land surface. And then sediments would build back out into that, and you'd have these terrestrial deposits laid down. And the plant fossils that we're finding are in the terrestrial deposits, of course, and then you would find various marine fossils in these limestones that were deposited at between the layers of the terrestrial beds.
Okay.
So they're interfingering here.
Gabriel, can you tell us what we are looking at here?
Well, this is part of this has fallen from this sequence of beds here, and you can see that there's a series of thinner and thicker beds. And they're basically flood horizons in which as the flood wanes, you get these deposits of finer grain material that fall out as water power decreases. Flood will carry a lot of sediment, and then as it slows down, the finer material comes out, and it's carrying plant material in it. And the plant material falls to the bottom and gets buried in these muddy layers. And what you see on the surface here are branches of a extinct plant called Walchia piniformis. And it's all one thing, and there are many fragments of branches that were probably being carried in the floodwaters, and they've fallen at odd angles. You can see this one's pointed this way, this one's pointed in a different direction over here. So they're not oriented by current. They appear to have drifted to the bottom and just fallen and then been covered by these muds. And probably the closest living model, so I really have a relative, but a plant with a similar kind of growth habit would be a plant that most of us are familiar with called Norfolk Island pine. You'll see it a lot of times in medical offices or buildings where they've got this conifer-like plant with these branches that occur in whorls, and as the branches die, they fall off. They kind of behave like fronds on a palm. They're entirely different. They're actually a branch. These little things are the leaves. So the little spiny bits are the leaves, and this is all part of a branch system. But the branches fell off of or were abscised from, in botanical terminology, abscised from the parent plant. And they'll be all through here. So this is one bedding surface, but many of these surfaces that you see in here would have these conifer branches distributed on them. And one of the things that perplexes us about this deposit and other deposits like this throughout New Mexico is the monotony of this flora. This plant we find from here all the way up to north of Albuquerque in exactly this kind of setting over and over and over again, not just bed by bed by bed in here, but in dozens and dozens of sites that we've investigated, we find exactly this kind of setting. So it's perplexing to us as to why.
So this will be a very common plant then in that period.
Right. Now, Jerry's named this conifer forest, and it implies that these are derived from some kind of conifer forest, that somehow these were feeding into the sediment stream during floods. Maybe waters were stripping the dead branches off of the surface of the ground and washing them into these flood waters, and then they're being carried along. They're probably fairly light. Once they're dead, I presume these are being deposited as dead branches and not ripped off the plants in storms. And they're very lightweight, and they're probably carried very easily in the floods. And then when the waters, again, slow down and pond, these things just settle to the bottom as they get waterlogged.
So how long would the plant need to be, I mean, an estimate, underwater for this to happen?
Well, probably not all that long, especially since what seems to be happening here is the floodwaters seem to be draining away. You'll notice on this that later you'll see that there are footprints. So the footprints imply that animals were able to walk across these muddy surfaces while they were still soft enough to make footprints. And in addition, there are mud cracks in here. So this stuff was ultimately exposed to the sun and cracked and sometimes even peeled up. So these things may have been floating in still water, and as the water drained away, they came down, but there still was enough mud to cover them, because you can see from the surfaces here that these, although they're in relief, they're three-dimensional, they still have a thin drape of mud over them, so they were still in water that was had a little bit of fine sediment that was settling with and on top of them as this whole thing took place. Probably, I would say this happened within days to hours after the flood began to wane. It's a pulse-like flooding environment. The floods are coming in, then they're waning, and the sun's cracking the mud, and another flood comes in, brings more sediment, buries this, then it wanes, and the more material gets deposited out. And you just stack it up, kind of like a loaf of bread, with one piece of bread, a little peanut butter on top of it, then another piece of bread, a little with peanut butter on top of it, and just stack the thing right up.
Well, these are conifer branches, primitive conifers. And I call this area conifer forest because of all the sites that I found. This area just has layer upon layer of conifer branches. And finding this led me to look in all these layers up here. I love this site because you look for fossils by looking up instead of down. And you can see tracks, you can see plants. And one of the important things to think about, because this is a real surreal kind of a site, it just doesn't make a lot of sense to someone that doesn't know fossils. All these layers were once perfectly flat, and all of these layers were once the surface of the Earth. There wasn't anything above it. And because the layers are basically of uniform thickness, that tells us that the relief was relatively flat. Now it's hardened, it's been tilted, and all of these layers have been built up. All these represent the surface of the Earth at one form or another, or at one time or another. And all of them preserve evidence of life. Plants, trackways of reptiles and amphibians, it's just phenomenal. So I love this site because you look for fossils by looking up, not down. And it has some of the best plant fossils of the primitive conifer walchia that you can find in the National Monument.